get up and talk. And what I've learned more than anything else in interviewing people is that you get a chance to interact with somebody and you learn to listen. I'm going to ask that everybody take on one small deed of kindness that they'll go out and do in the world, whatever it is. And maybe it'll be to listen to someone who has a story to tell. Often we like to talk, but there's so much power in listening. And it's obvious to me that you believe that already, or you wouldn't be here tonight. Tonight I want to introduce Mrs. Stefania Hecht. She was introduced to me by a board member here on the board of the Young Friends. And she has an incredible story, which we're going to hear in just a few minutes. In addition to hearing the story, I want to try to paint, I'm going to attempt to paint a larger picture of what was happening during Mrs. Hecht's story. I know for myself, when I first started to read books about the Holocaust, and I was very interested in the subject from a young age, even though my family actually was not in the Shoah. And to be honest, I always thought that the Shoah had a certain story pattern. 1938, the Germans take over, it gets bad, everybody goes to a ghetto, and then for a certain amount of time, things are terrible, the atrocities that people went through, and then liberation. When I started to interview Mrs. Hecht, I realized that there was big holes in my understanding of the Shoah, and it made me realize that there are so many different stories. 6 million people died. That means even more went through the Shoah, each one with a very different storyline. That's one of the wonderful things I like about this event, is that we get a chance to learn, not only hear a story, but learn different aspects of what happened to people in the Shoah. In past years, we've interviewed people from Germany, from Poland, and this year we're interviewing somebody from Hungary. And I'm going to try to paint a picture of what was going on in Hungary, and how that's a little bit different than what was going on in Poland, France, Czechoslovakia, so many different places. Before we begin, I want to just read something. Zach mentioned something from Hela Wiesel, and I want to read something as well about the Shoah. How does one mourn for 6 million people who died? How many candles does one light? How many prayers does one recite? Do we know how to remember victims? Their solitude, their helplessness? They left without a trace. We are their trace. We tell these stories because perhaps we know that not to listen or not to want to know would lead to indifference, and indifference is never the answer. So let's begin our story. Born in, she doesn't want to say it. I'm going to tell you what I'm going to do. Stefania was born before the war in Hungary, except for at the time it wasn't Hungary, it was Romania. And this is important because after 1940, parts of Romania were annexed by Hungary. The Hungarian story is unique in that until approximately 1944, There were terrible things going on in Hungary. The Jews had limited rights. They weren't able to vote. Hundreds of thousands of people lost their jobs because they weren't allowed to work. Many things were amiss. But for the vast majority of them, they were not transported to places like Auschwitz, Dachau, various camps. They lived their lives in Hungary, mostly unaware of what was going on in the rest of the world. Here are some facts about what was going on in Hungary, the Hungary that Mrs. Hecht knew before the war. There was a thriving Jewish community. There were famous Hasidic dynasties. People went to school, the universities. Over 50% of the doctors in Hungary were Jewish. Over 50% of the lawyers were just about were Jewish. Sounds familiar. they were were in media, they were in publishing. They had active youth groups. It was the largest Jewish community in Eastern Europe. Mrs. Heft, can you tell us a little bit about your memories of Romania or Hungary, depending on the war? Do you remember what it was like to spend Shabbat with your family?
My father was very involved with the shul. We lived close from the shul. And we went regularly Shabbos to shul. My little brother went to Heder. I don't remember much about my older brother because I was very young. And we kept all the holidays. And we were happy children till problem came that my mother died.
How old were you?
I was 5 years old. My two siblings, they were 1 year old. And it was very sad situation. I really didn't understand much because I was only 5. But later on, growing, my older sister died. Oh, I was 8 years old. She was already 15. And definitely, it was a very big problem for us, younger children. And of course, my mother's aunt saw the situation that we are no neighbors to help. She didn't have children, and she came to help us out. And of course, after years, my father tried to save our house. It was a fire on the street, and he had to take the water from the well and pour it over the house. And after, I don't know how long he was doing that, because I was very young, they picked us up and they took us to our cousin for the night. And by the time we came home the other day, he was he wind up in the cellar because he was overheated and he got a stroke. So, of course, I was 8 years old when he got sick, and he was sick for 2 years. I remember very well, my brother used to put his Twilight Moses on his hand every morning. And it was very difficult family life because we were without parents. So remembering much, I really don't know because I was very young.
Since your parents, right? Since your father and his...
Yes, he was in the 1917 war. And that my mother, she was very young because she had 1 year old twins.
Mm-hmm. When she passed away.
And she passed away.
So by the time you were 10, you were an orphan. And her mother had passed away when you were 5.
Yes.
And your older sister had gotten sick and she had passed away.
Yes.
And then your father passed away all before the war happened, or right around early
1938, my father died. I was then 10 years old.
Can you tell us a little bit about this picture?
Yes. Before the war, those are my, that's me, my sibling, my twin brother and sister, and my older brother.
What were their names?
My brother, the younger brother was Buri, the sister was Leia, and my brother was Yossi.
Older brother.
Yeah, and my name in Jewish was Prima. And of course I had a fifth sister who I don't know about her, where she's buried. It was a difficult situation because we were all young, and sadly, we couldn't have a picture from her. I remember her, how she looked. They kept telling me that she was a beautiful girl. And it was a very sad situation, being without dad, being without older sisters.
And that was before the war. That was before the war. So then tell me, after your parents had passed, they had to split you up, right?
Yes.
Your brother stayed in the original house.
Yes.
The twins stayed there as well.
Yes.
But you were sent to live with an aunt.
My father's sister.
Father's sister. And that's where you stayed until approximately 1944.
A couple of years, yeah. I went to school there, and of course, when the Germans came in, everybody had to go home to their workplace because they wanted to know everybody is there. Then we didn't know anything, of course. We didn't dream about what happened. And
but they sent you home.
They had to send me home because they had a law that everybody has to stay home where they were born. And of course, the Hungarians came in.
Yeah, let's explain that. So this is Romania before 1940. I actually had to pull this up for myself because my great-grandmother used to say the same thing. If you were to ask her where she was from, she would say, it depends on the war. So this is as much to help me, and maybe it'll be helpful to you as well. It's important to the storyline. So Mrs. Heft is from Romania, and this is before 1940. After 1940, Hungary had come in and annexed large portions of surrounding states, including Romania. The reason why this is important is because in 1944, the Germans came into Hungary, and Hungary did not put out a fight. They allowed the Germans to come in, and once the Germans came in, they enacted the strongest, fastest, final solution of any state or city in Europe. If you look over here, it says annexed from Rome, from Romania, that's where Mrs. Heft lived. So it was a situation of history that because the borders had changed, she had gone from living in a country which was not, they had their own atrocities, but what was about to happen wouldn't have happened if she had been in Romania. Let me explain a little further. In 1944, this man, was a famous Nazi, arrived in Budapest on March 19th, 1944, and he came in to occupy Hungary. His mission was to deport nearly 800,000 Jews from a territory of some 66,000 square miles. Yet here's the kicker. He only brought between 20, according to some, and 100 soldiers. 20, 100 soldiers. In addition to that, he had a little bet. The largest amount of people to ever have been deported at one time was in the Warsaw Ghetto, where they were able to deport something in the vicinity of 275,000 Jews from the Warsaw Ghetto. Eichmann wanted to beat that. He came in with the twisted rivalry of, I'm going to deport more Jews in Hungary than they were able to do in Warsaw. What he wasn't expecting was the amount of enthusiasm that he was met with the Hungarians. He didn't need to bring in more than 100 troops because the Hungarians themselves were happy to help in this terrible process. Let me give you a few facts, just to show you how fast, and then we're going to go back to Mrs. Heft's story, but this is just to show you there isn't a long drawn out process of first being in ghettos for a long time, and 3 years later this happens and that happens. Mrs. Heft's story happens in a much shorter span of time. It's 1944. The Allied troops are already advancing. Germany knows they're not going to win the war. April 5th, Hungary implants wearing a Jewish star. Do you remember what you
mean? Sure.
But it wasn't something that you grew up with, right?
No.
Tell us about
that. And we didn't know why we were wearing that.
Just all of a sudden, you were told you had to wear a star.
It was terrible. Everybody was looking, walking on the street. They wasn't pleasant people,
and
like the Romanian and the Hungarian. We were stunned.
April 5th, they were told to put on a star. April 7th of the same year, the Hungarians decided to create ghettos for the entirety of the Hungarian population. By the end of May, 200 ghettos and camps had been created in Hungary. Between May 15th and July 9th of 1944, Hungarian authorities deported 437,402 Hungarian Jews and 147 Jews in 56 days. Eichmann beat his rival in deporting more Jews and anybody at any given time in the history of the Holocaust. To make this a little bit more, the numbers are so enormous, and I was trying to think of what could we even, in our modern day, try to imagine what that looks like. This is Giant Stadium, or otherwise known as MetLife Stadium. It holds approximately 80,000 people on a full day. Right around this time, we're in the beginning of May, that's when Mrs. Hecht's story begins. They deported five stadiums full of Jews between now and 4th of July weekend. 437,000 Jews. 90% of the people who were deported went to Auschwitz. If you came from the rural countryside, the way Mrs. Hecht did, you had less than a 10% chance of survival. That's how incredible it is that Mrs. Hecht is here, and she's here with her children and her grandchildren and her great-grandchildren. It's a miracle. How is it possible, aside from the incredible speed and efficiency that the Germans were, yes, indeed, known for, but still, how is it that nobody knew? Did you know? Did you hear? He didn't hear anything. This was common. This was a common lack of knowledge that one would find in Hungary around 1944. They figured the war is almost over. What happens in the rest of Europe is not going to happen here. And when they were told to get on cattle cars at the rate of 12,000 people per day, people didn't know where they were going. There were a few people who were warned. In fact, the couple of the German soldiers that were brought into Hungary were ironically stationed in Jewish people's homes, and one of them was in Mrs. Hecht's home. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
He was a very nice person, mm-hmm. And he was telling my brother, I know what's coming up to you guys. You have to do something, because it's not going to be a good ending. And he was telling us that it's going to be sad, very sad. Do something.
Go to Romania.
Excuse me?
Go to Romania, leave the country.
Yeah. And then my brother said, after he left, that how we can leave? What we want to do with our aunt, my mother aunt. She was a very old lady, 65 years old. We should leave her, that's impossible. She took care of us when we were very young. And we decided we're gonna stay. But we didn't know why we're staying, what's gonna happen. We just wait and see.
Do you remember when you were rounded up?
Yeah, me, let us know very quickly, pack your bag, and we're gonna take you to a big place. Why? We didn't know. We just packed our bag, some food, and we, like a big, not little apartment, was a big area.
The ghettos of Hungary were a little different than the ghettos you might have read about in Poland.
Yes.
Over the course, again, we're talking about 56 days that this enormous transport happened. Sometimes single buildings were turned into ghettos. They were transportation holders. They would send Jews from small little villages to larger, to these, like a building. Sometimes it was one building, sometimes it was a group of buildings. The difference between these ghettos and ghettos you may have read about in other parts of Europe were they weren't erected and populated for years and years at a time. Sometimes they were put together and liquidated within a matter of days or weeks, at most a month or two.
Yes.
And that's where you went.
Definitely.
And can you describe the second ghetto that you were put into?
And they surrounded the area and the city that I live, all the Jews, then they started to send them to another ghetto, which was worse, or how should I put it? None of them was good. And it was a farm, and they had little places for the animals,
pens.
So there they put us, each family, and still we didn't know what's going to happen.
Did they feed you?
Actually,
did they give you food?
No, only what we brought with us, very little. We had to make sure that we're going to have for tomorrow, or for after tomorrow. And after all, by the time they put us in the wagon, in the trains, of course the food got rotten. So we didn't have any food to eat. I don't know how we survived.
And
only just Hashem helped us. Who survived all from Hashem.
There were stories, your son was telling me, we were talking about this the other day, in these ghettos as well, they tortured people, right?
They
were looking for money.
Yes, they heard the screaming. They didn't let anybody out from the place I was standing.
What were they looking for?
They were looking for gold, for money, whatever they had to. They didn't have, they had to tell, where is your money? Because they have to get the money from the gold. So they were, some they were saying, some not, and they were beating them. But we didn't see the beating, we just heard the screaming.
Eventually, you were taken by cattle cars,
yeah.
To Auschwitz.
Yeah.
Tell us about that.
We were like 70 people put into this cattle car. Me, my aunt, and my twin brother and sister, we wind up in a corner on the floor, and we were just waiting. What's going to happen? We were asking each other. But nobody knew anything. And after a couple of days, we arrived to Auschwitz. And over there, they opened the door, and they started to scream, "Schnell, schnell, we should quickly leave everything in the train." So everybody, whatever the sister or brother, they hold their hand, went down on the steps. My old aunt, she was very poorly broken, but soon they got up off the train. They were sent to the left, to the right, and I was sent to the right. And we saw people shaved, and we talked to each other. Why these people are shaved? Why are they not normal? And of course, quickly, they did everything quickly. They sent us also into that room.
Who were you with? Were you with anybody?
I wasn't with anybody.
What happened to your aunt in the 20s?
They went to the right.
Did you get a chance to say that?
We didn't know anything then. But after all, we find out that they took them to the crematorium.
So you got out of the train, and your aunt and your siblings,
We had to separate.
And you didn't get a chance to say goodbye?
Not even turn around, because they were pushing us going to the right.
And then very quickly you were entered into Auschwitz, they shaved your head.
Yes.
And then they told you to take a shower. Then they told you to take a shower. Did they tell you to bathe or to...
No, after the end, they sent us to the washroom. And there we set up things where you're washing your hands, but not bathing. And they told us, leave your clothes on the floor, you just take your shoes, and you're going to get another piece of schmuck. I can say it. And that's what you were wearing the whole year. No bathing, no shampoo. And we wind up in a barrack. We were like 30, 31 barracks. And our barracks number was number 20. And they pushed in over there like 900 girls. We were all women, girls. And each on the barrack 20, there was the worst barrack on the area. It was no bunk beds.
No.
And it
what
was
did you sleep on? What did you sleep on?
On the floor, pure floor.
Were there windows?
And it was on top, it was a window where definitely that hurt my ear and I got a very bad ear infection.
You were sick for a long time because of that, right?
For a couple of weeks. And then I decided I'm going to look for my aunt, my cousin's wife.
Just want to pause just for there for a second. What did you do while you were in the camp? Did you work?
No, not at all.
So you came in, just stuck in a barrack and they didn't give you anything to do.
Nothing. We were talking about cooking food, but the food was not there.
And what happened to people who couldn't handle it?
Many, they went into the barbed wire.
They committed suicide. On the barbed wire.
Yeah. And many, they lost their mind. And they started screaming during the night. So in every morning, early 3 o'clock, they put us on the side of the barrack they should count us. Every morning they were counting. Not one of them should miss.
What would happen if someone was missing?
They were looking for that. And some they were missing because they killed themselves. And then if they made the counting, they started again. And they kept us in the cold, weather, raining.
So you would stand for hours and hours and hours until they would count you?
Just... And when they finished, they got the number completely, then we were able to go back to the bar.
So I want to sum up for the audience. You didn't have parents at this point.
No.
The twins were gone.
Yes.
Your aunt was gone.
Yes.
Where was your brother?
My brother was taken from the ghetto. One morning they come and they knock the door because they knew everybody where it is. And they told him to go with them. And he left, and from then that morning I never saw him.
So you've lost at this point your entire family. And at this point in Auschwitz, you were by yourself.
That was not in Auschwitz when they took him.
But when you were in Auschwitz, everything.
Yes.
And at that point, it must have been very lonely for you.
Very lonely, very. Because everybody was stick to their mother, who was together with their mother, but I didn't have, because the mothers were young, so they survived with the daughters.
But your aunt didn't, who she was murdered.
Yes. And I was very lonely. And then I knew that I have a cousin from a different town where I went to school. And I was on a wedding, so I knew her very well. And after I decided I had to look for somebody, to have somebody around me. Because before that I was lonely, because I lost my parents, and after that again. So I figured this will be the closest.
And you knew she was in Auschwitz at this point. You had heard and you figured that her transport had come in.
Everybody, yeah. She was taken from a different transport. Mm-hmm.
But you figured you would go and look for her in the camp.
And then I find out the area, which area she could be. And I asked people for something to let us out for a couple hours for fresh air. Mm-hmm. And my interest was I should look for her. And then I find her, and she was pregnant.
She was married and had been trying to have a baby for many years, and then she got to the camps and was actually pregnant.
That year she got pregnant, and definitely she was very, very, very into for the piece of schmata
to make it solve
for the baby something. If the baby comes.
Yeah.
I was there and I saw her sewing. I don't know from where, how she got there.
How long did you, when once you found each other, it must have been so nice to finally meet.
A couple months, yeah.
And you snuck out of your own bag.
Yes.
And then decided to stay in her bag, right?
In her bag, yeah.
And you got a chance to spend a couple of months with her.
Yes.
And was she able to hide the fact that she was pregnant?
She was able to hide because she stood in the line with heavier people.
So she would hide behind other people to hide.
One line, but they didn't realize that she's pregnant.
So she made it full term.
Yes.
And then what happened?
And then she, one night, during the night, she woke up screaming. We took her to the infirmary. And in the morning, of course, I heard the screaming. In the morning, I got up and I went to the infirmary and I saw the baby, beautiful baby, red haired baby, and because she was also red haired. And I was very happy to see it. I didn't know what was going to happen, but already when I went, the baby wasn't there. And the third day when I went, she was taken also because she was sick. We didn't care about her. Just take the baby and let the baby take the baby and I never saw them.
So again,
I was by myself. It was very, very emotional thing for me. Again, to be alone.
To be alone?
Yes.
How long were you in Auschwitz for?
Half a year,
5 months, over the course of the summer.
In September, Mengele came and he selected 250 girls to a factory where I was working for the Germans.
Why did they choose you?
They distributed line and Mengele, young, 16 years old.
So you were the right age, you weren't too young?
Yeah.
Because they would have sent you to the crematorium.
Definitely.
And if you were even a little older,
yeah,
they would have sent you away.
Yes.
They needed you for work.
Yeah.
So you got away because he chose you because of your age.
And I was saying, like, in this condition, not in this condition.
You look great. So you were in Auschwitz for 5 months.
Yes.
You lost whatever family you had left. You found other family, you lost them as well.
Yes.
You were there for 5 months. Mengele chose you with about 200 girls.
Yeah.
And you were taken to a labor camp. Where you stayed.
Czechoslovakia.
And how was that compared to Auschwitz? How was that different?
Different. big difference, the difference. We got right away our cup, potato in it, and that was everything.
There was more food than you were getting in Auschwitz.
Yes,
which
definitely.
Was, what did you eat when you were in Auschwitz?
They just gave us a piece of bread and a coffee, which was just dark, but not coffee.
And that was it for the day?
And in the afternoon, they gave us some liquid, which looked really like water, and some potatoes swimming in it, and grass.
Grass?
So, yes, grass. Because we felt it when we were chewing on our teeth.
Wow. You were in the labor camp until basically the end of the war.
I mean, in September.
In September. Did you have any friends when you were in the labor camp? Were you able to meet up anybody else, any other family?
Yes, I met two girls which were my age, because they were different ages. And we got very close to each other, helped each other. And but one of them got sick with tuberculosis. Wrong infection. And my girl came and they took her
away.
So
how
the one survived together with me. So we were very close.
And when in 1945, when the war was over, how did you find out that it was over? Because it was impossible, there were no radios, you didn't have any newspapers.
An older German came to the factory. He was very nice. He told us, let's go with everybody in the yard and I'm going to have a speech telling you guys, be careful if you go out from here. Make sure that you're not going to be shot from a German or a Russian repeat or raped from a Russian, because they were looking for girls. And we were waiting 3 days over there, but the food ran out. We had to keep going. And we marched out from the factory, and we reached the French people were working there. And we stopped by, and the whole doors went to look around in the kitchen. They found some food, and they shake for all the dogs. And after that, we had to keep moving, because nobody cared about us. Who survived under American soldiers, we were treated, we got everything.
But you weren't in America.
But the Russians, they didn't care. So we had to think.
So how did you, on the trains, what did you do to keep yourself safe when you got on the train?
We had to make sure we hiding in the place that feeding the train.
The coal. You were hiding in the coal car.
Yeah.
And that's how
you came out from there. We were completely back.
And you came out. And where were you going? You took the train.
We didn't know which part of the country is going. Mm-hmm. We just happy you get a train to go in.
Anywhere. Yeah.
So luckily it went up that we arrived to Budapest.
In Budapest.
Yeah, and over there was the Sofnut already.
The Sofnut, which was the
Israeli organization.
Organization trying to help people emigrate to Israel
definitely.
And help the Jewish
very
people.
Much, very much, very much. And
were they able to help you? There were boards people could write who came back and who didn't come back. Did you find anybody on the boards when you came back?
I found a friend of mine who was on the board. She came back, but no idea why, but she died in something like it after everything.
And you were still sick, right? You had an ear infection that I got in Auschwitz that was perpetually coming back, and you landed up in the hospital for some reason.
And I wind up, when I finally got home to my hometown, and that the day, before it became an open place, the delegation went home, and it was drafty, so my ear infection became worse. And the other day, my cousin took me to a VCT in Romania. But then all I did became Romania again. And I was there for 2 months with my ear till they healed. Thank God. It's sensitive, but I'm here.
And you have ear.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually, you know, so now you're back and the war is over. And compared to other places, people came back and they resettled in Hungary and they resettled in Romania.
Yeah.
And what did you do after the war? Did you settle? Did you try to leave?
First of all, I resettled in my parents' house. My cousin who helped us out when we were orphaned with the store, he came back also to that town. And he fixed it up because it was bombed. It was very close to the post office, and it was the post office, and then it reached our house. So he took care, and then I was there. And yes, just my cousin.
Mm-hmm. And the little boy, babysat
him for a while. And then, by the time I came back, the other day I got sober from the infection. So he took me to the hospital.
And when you were feeling better and you had come back, you settled with them for a few years, right? And they were your family.
Yeah, I babysat.
You babysat for them. Why did you end up leaving?
From
when you stayed there for a bit and at some point you left. Why did you go?
Yeah, I was 21 years old already.
And you weren't married.
And I wasn't married.
And she was 21. And you were not married yet. And
I missed family.
Yes.
Very much. And then I decided I'm going to keep moving. And somebody from a city, he went there for yeshiva to meet my wife from the Auschwitz. He survived his father. He told me, why don't you go to this orphanage home and the Sukkot is going to help you to go
to Israel. So there was an orphanage.
And that was my dream.
And you wanted to go to Israel, so you figured you would go to this, you would travel to this other orphanage and then you would make Aliyah to Israel.
Yes.
That was what you were expecting.
That was my plan.
But what happened?
And then, by coincidence, of course, first of all, we had to be together with other orphanage children. They were younger. We had to cook and feed them. And then Shabbos, we kept Shabbos. This happened before Purim. And Saturday, we went for a walk with my friend. And my husband came back from Russia in 1948. They took him from the not army, from the where they were taking the young people to work.
It's like slave labor camp.
Slave labor, yeah. And they took all of these boys to Russia, and they kept them, even the war was over, they kept them till 1948, but 1948 finally he came home. And
so you're taking a walk.
So his family didn't come home, of course. And he took also a walk. He came down to that town. And I met the man on the street, and from that minute he didn't let me go. He just wanted to marry me. And of course, I was very lonely. He was a very nice woman. And when I told him that, because he wanted to take me to his hometown, and I said, I don't have money. He said, don't worry, I will take it together. And I said, I'm not going by myself. I said, I have to ask my friend if she wants to come. And my friend came. And she was also in the fourth mission. So we had a very nice time there. One family already married, and my husband, ex-husband, he was very good friends, and we spent a lot of time with these people. And then he took us there. He asked them to let us sleep there for the night. And the other day he took us to his home, to his family house, parents' house. And he was very generous, and we ate lunch, and he took us back to the flat, and we spent the afternoon together in Pakistan. And at night, Jane went back to where we were. But between, he said, you know what, I would like to take you to my cousin. They were all married already, because that was already 1949. And I said, okay. Again, I said, I don't have money. So he said, don't worry. We went back in Oralia, big city, and introduced me to them. And his cousin's husband was working with jewelry and watches, and he told them already, you know what, bring two rings. And in Europe those days, lunchtime, they were old people. And we ordered two rings, and that was it. In a month, we were engaged and married.
Mrs. Heff stayed in Romania. An interesting twist again. The common story that a lot of people hear is that at the end of the war, people were displaced, and for most people, the goal was to get out of the country. Many moved to other parts of to Canada, America, to Israel, Australia, South America. We don't often hear the narrative that people stayed in Europe, but your family stayed for 15 years after the war.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Communism had taken over at a certain point, and it became very difficult to leave. To get out of the country, Israel had partnered, or was trying to partner with Romania. They were paying per head to get Jews out of Europe to send them to Israel, but of course, government knowing that another government is going to pay for every person that is going to come along, will try to extort as much money as possible, make it difficult. And at some point, your husband, who spoke fluent Russian,
yes,
was a commodity, and they wouldn't let him leave, right? So your children, actually, some of them are in the audience, and they're really cute. And it's in Romania, right? And you came to America in
1964.
And how many children did you have?
I had three children.
Three children.
I had six grandchildren, but one of them. And I have 20 great grandchildren. And coming two more. First,
anything in closing that you want to share to tell the young people, the next generation, the people who have come here tonight to listen to your story? What do you want to share with them before we close? What message would you like to give them?
You should think ahead. Life is very cruel. Try to be happy, not to be alone. It's terrible, the loneliness. And I wish them all the nachas and happiness. They should raise children and have grandchildren and raise grandchildren.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. I hope.